Who's up? Who's down?
Andrew, why don't you lead us off?
Dan Orlovsky gets my who's up. The reason he's been added to ESPN's number two Monday Night Football team with Steve Levy and Lewis Riddick. The first team, of course, is Joe Buck and Troy Aikman. And look, you look at the guys who are getting these jobs. Usually it's people who've had great quarterbacking careers in the NFL. Dan Orlovsky did not have that. He was a standout at UConn, and then he spent 11 or 12 years in the NFL, mostly as a backup and most known for running out of the back of the end zone. Let me just say, I have so much respect, though, for anybody who plays in the NFL. I think people are like, oh, that guy's not good. Yeah, you go try to play 11 years in the NFL. Just accomplishing that is an amazing accomplishment. But now he gets to, he's worked his way up where he's in this small group where he's in a big booth. Now, they'll only do three games this year, then five next year, but he has a chance to establish himself to be a regular NFL analyst. You know, maybe one day he's in that lead Monday night booth. Maybe one day he's, you know, on Sundays in a booth in a one or two, but he's in that conversation now. And you think about it, he came out, was it 4 or 5 years ago, kind of an unknown. I mean, I knew the name because of his UConn days and, you know, and then of course back up in the NFL, but and that one play where he ran out of the back of the end zone, but now he's established himself. And so good for him. Hard work paid off in the case of Dan Orlovsky.
My who's up? Leslie Visser. Talk about a trailblazing journalist. She was awarded the Lifetime Achievement Award by the Sports Emmys. And I know everybody likes to take their shots at the Sports Emmys, but I happen to be and have always been a big fan of the program because, you know, it's one thing about sort of honoring the on-air talent that gets all the headlines, but I've been to so many of those events and you just get to see these behind the scenes producers, directors, people that get no notoriety, really get honored for their work. Sports Business Journal, we just put on our Sports Business Awards last week and we saw the same thing. ESPN swept the media categories, best media company and best in ESPN Plus got best in digital. But you saw some of the sort of smaller categories and the people that won, it just sort of really validated them. And it's really nice to see.
100%. It means a lot to people. I will say sometimes when I've been who wins, I sometimes disagree.
Sometimes you scratch your head. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah, so you're like, wait, that one over there? Okay. But it does mean a lot to people. And, you know, having that Emmy on your mantle at home is a cool thing, especially when you have friends over and neighbors and whatnot. All right, on the way down, I'm going to go first here. Magic Johnson and ESPN. Now, I don't know if there's something else going on with Magic and ESPN, but there was some ballyhoo when he was hired. He's been on ESPN's pregame show one time this year, and I'm not really certain if he's even going to be on during the finals. Just a weird one. You know, Magic's had a few of these over the years. I think he kind of left ESPN originally when he first was there, that first go around, kind of in the middle of like the playoffs. And then, you know, we saw what happened with the Lakers, and now only one appearance, and it might be the only one as far as I can tell. Now, there could be some other things going on, but I will say Magic has done a disappearing act on ESPN.
On the way down, I could have picked so many people. The NFL's head business executive, Brian Rolapp, he told SBJ's Ben Fisher to tell us that he never listens to the pod. Andrew, I think he protests too much.
I don't buy it. Number one, Brian, it's not. You're my who's down. There you go. Who's down, Brian Rolapp. I'm changing mine. Magic, you're out. You don't listen to the pod, you're out.
You're out. You're done. You're consistently down. Greg Norman, what a bad week for Greg Norman again. He was my who's down last week. He could have been who's down again. But I'm going back to the well this week, Andrew. Who's down? Chris Ripley of Sinclair.
Chris Ripley? I mean, this guy, holy cow. Chris Ripley, we might have to call it the Chris Ripley Who's Down Award. It's kind of like when Jordan or LeBron are up for the MVP. It's like, you know, they should really deserve it every year, but then somebody else gets it. So anyways, why do you have Ripley this week?
Well, my second job in journalism, I started in a newspaper and I went in and I covered cable trades and I covered these affiliate deals hard. And I've been sort of in the middle of them for decades now. And there's a certain way that the two companies approach these deals. And Chris Ripley doesn't seem to have learned anything from his problems with Dish Network and getting something done with Charter. He was at Moffitt Nathanson at a Moffitt Nathanson conference where he talked about a DirecTV negotiation that we're still a year away from. And he basically put down the gauntlet with DirecTV. He said, quote, "I don't believe that MVPDs," which is cable operators, distributors, "such as DirecTV are going to be willing to take the risk to go without some key product," meaning that they're going to be there to get the RSNs. He said, "We already crossed the Rubicon on direct-to-consumer because we already had the rights to negotiate it in advance." He's partly right on that, but this isn't how you negotiate in cable. Cable is such a relationship business, and he's an outlier that is putting his thumb on the scale, and if he can hold DirecTV to it, here's one thing. I talk to people at DirecTV. They look at Dish Network. Ever since Dish Network dropped the RSNs, they've been making more money than they have in the past. The RSNs are high priced and sort of a loss leader for a lot of these distributors. So a lot of people look the other way as well. Well, we don't need to spend all that money just to keep a local fans, especially when you're going to go direct to consumer. So it's going to be a really interesting negotiation coming forward. But that was a bomb. I mean, he already threw a bomb in there more than a year away. Incredible. I've never seen anything like that.
So Ripley either has more who's down on the Ourand scorecard coming up or a dramatic turn where he gets who's up if he gets these deals with DirecTV done. I'm not going to say they won't get a deal done, but that it the numbers that they might like the numbers that they want.
Yeah, I don't want to say it's unlikely because these deals always get done, but there could be a lot of rancor and there could be a lot of bloodletting in between now and the time the deal gets done.